As usual, Madan Bhai, you ask most difficult question and call them easy question. This is a very tough one. Now you see this issue about what is Atman, what is Paramatman, how do we define them, and what is the relationship is very central in Hindu philosophy. In fact, all the acharyas we've had, starting from Adi Shankara, Ramanuj, Madhava, etc., all of them have been tussling with this issue, this question. In fact, this is how you have all these different acharyas and different movements within Hinduism in the last 1,000 years, tackling this issue. What is going on? I'll give you my take, what is my personal, if you like, ideology. How do I see this issue? You see, first of all, the word Atman is very difficult to encapsulate, to understand what is meant by Atman. We see it in all the scriptures, Atman, Atman, everywhere. You ask any Hindu, especially your parents, what is Atman? They say vegetable on Ealing Road. No idea. They're struggling. The word itself is, you know, they will say every scripture will have about Atman and Brahman. And they say, what is the word? What is it? We don't know. It's just something, just read in the scripture and we recite the poetry and the verses. So what is this? When you really try and explore the word Atman, what it actually means, there are certain handles that you can use to try and grab this thing called Atman. And the three handles the Hindus have used, in fact, there are more than three, but the three that really, you know, stands out are the ones that Madan Bhai mentioned. The nearest words you have in the vocabulary that will allow you to try and get a handle on the word Atman, on the concept of Atman, is consciousness. It is of the nature of consciousness. So this idea comes as asti, as bhati in the Sanskrit vocabulary. This is one handle you have. The thing that we possess that seems to be very close to our being, we are conscious. Our consciousness seems to be central. That's my own being, consciousness. So the word says, Hinduism says, the word consciousness in a way is hiding this concept of Atman. It appears, the nearest word is consciousness, that's one. The second word that gives you a handle on this concept of Atman is the word existence. You say existence? It's such a casual word. Everything exists. There's a cup of tea, this is here, there's a glass, there's not glass. So what's the big deal about existence? No, no, no. Hinduism says what appears as a casual word that we use in our casual life is hiding the secret of the Atman. Existence, it is of the nature of existence, says Hindu tradition. Asti, existence. The word asti became existence in English. It actually is literally from the word asti, S-E-T, and then existence. So existence is the nature of Atman. The fact that existence, we exist without a straightforward thing. No, the fact that we exist, it's not this only thrilling thing. We exist. That takes you to the heart of reality. You are that. That's the second part. The third part is the sweetie. It says, the third aspect of the word Atman, the third handle we have on the word Atman is, it is of the nature of bliss. Be careful. Bliss doesn't mean pleasure. Pleasure you get from ice cream, especially me, chocolate ice cream, I love it. That is not bliss. That is pleasure. The senses get excited in a positive way and we feel, yes, I want more. And that is not bliss. Bliss is something dramatically different from pleasure and pain. It transcends both pleasure and pain. And that is something that is within us. It is when we recognize, if we have our center of gravity, not as pleasure and pain, but we focus back on bliss, then we are in a way freed from this chasing after pleasure or running away from pain. We recognize our dignity as blissful. Again, how do I know these things? When religion becomes experiential, when you actually experience what is this Atman about, this is what happens. You feel, first of all, you feel a thrill, I exist. Oh, you say, oh, it's a simple thing. No, when you experience the spirit, the word existence, God catches you, I exist. Your hair on your body stands on end. And you feel tremendous bliss flowing through your system. Not pleasure, bliss flowing through your system. You feel excited. This is bliss, this is not pleasure. It is something dramatically different from pleasure. We are trying to find bliss by searching for pleasure. We thought pleasure is what we are looking for. No, it's bliss what we are searching for. So the three words, Sat, Chit, Anand, or Asti, Bhati, Priya, existence, consciousness, and bliss are central, if you like, the best way if you can use to try and capture what is meant by Atman. But again, look, these are just words. The reality is, it is experiential. Words fall by the wayside. This is the best we can do when we are trying to converse about it or talk about it. We use the next nearest words. This is, if you like, the definition of what Atman. Now, by definition, there is no limitation. Existence is existence. And bliss is bliss. So the by definition, Atman is actually, you know, logically, no different from how we define Paramatman, a superior Atman, a special Atman. And the Hindus have brought in the word Paramatman for a particular reason. I'll mention to you in a minute. Now I can say I'm the Atman, I talk about bliss and existence and oh, I'm that. If I'm in that state, actually I'm experiencing myself as the Atman, I have no interest in Paramatman. But the moment I don't experience myself as the Atman, but as this individual saying, what's going on around here? Then I'm stuck. Atman is just words. So then I conjure up this marvelous chap called Paramatman. Because as I can't grab hold of this thing called Atman, I have now projected this idea of Paramatman as, if you like, not just an ordinary Atman, but a superior Atman. For me to focus my mind to grab this Atman, I produce Paramatman. Because then what I do is, I can then build relationship with this Paramatman. It's a chap outside me, not me, outside me. So I can build relationship. I've got some tools to progress spiritually. In order for you to progress spiritually, the thing that you are searching for, you need to project it outward and then build relationship with it. That is Paramatman. Now this is purely Adi Shankara's interpretation. Watch it. Adi Shankara, the first Acharya, famous Acharya who brought back Hinduism to India. Otherwise, Hinduism was knocked out. And it's Adi Shankara with this very high philosophy approach was able to give rebirth to Hinduism. No, don't underestimate the power of this man. But then, you see, this is philosophically satisfying, but not practical. When you say, I am Atman, I am the Paramatman, I am the same, one and only, this is called Advaita philosophy. It is philosophically satisfying, but is impractical. You will find hardly one, I have not met one single Advaita Vedanti. Advaiti means I am the Atman, who is actually experienced Atman. So this guy is just living in a dream world. I would rather link with a person who says, I love God as Paramatman, I am devoted to him, because he's got his teeth into the system and he makes progress. The guy says, I'm Atman, just is hot air. And I met a lot of them and I run away from them. I don't like them. They're philosophic giants, but experientially they're complete duds. I rather have a person who says, I love God, I love Paramatman, he's my love of my life. He's building, he's got his teeth in the system, he's using its certain tools to progress. It is only at the experiential level that the distinction between Atman and Paramatman disappears. At the practical level, I am a Vishishta Dvaiti. Vishishta, not Advaiti, Vishishta Dvaiti. He says, I am just a little tiddler. I am just a spark. God is the great fire. And by looking at fire, I can then recognize my essential nature as a spirit. But to progress, I need to be practical, not philosophical. Oh, I'm so clever. What good is that cleverness? You know? It's better to be practical, pragmatic. So for example, I'll tell you frankly, if I'm in the bliss of experiencing that I'm the spirit, I don't need him. But when I'm not in that state, in my daily life, I'm chewing, I'm having my cereals, I'm in trouble. I got all sorts of pains, I need help. So I look at Paramatman, if you like, rediscovering myself through some personality. This is the difference between Atman and Paramatman. At the experiential level, the distinction, that demarcation disappears. But until you get that, be humble. See, this is Ramanuj. Be humble. Until you experience yourself as God, don't say you are God. That is nonsense. Say that I am a devotee of God. I am just a devotee searching for God. And that will allow me to progress. Otherwise, you just sit, I am God. What more? You are not a God, you are an idiot. But I say, I am looking for God. You are going to progress, my friend. That is why Vishishta Dvaita, in a way, is the more pragmatic philosophy, even though Advaita is philosophically more satisfying. These are the major distinctions. But I think it's very beautiful, as usual, Madan Bhai asks the most difficult questions. Mm-hmm.